Please welcome our young associate artist, Sean Shannon.
I wanted to speak a bit today about each composer and the piece or pieces that I'm playing. So I suppose let's start with a bit about who Bach was as a person. So in general, he was a deeply religious man. He had a very strong Christian faith, and pretty much all of his music is either some sort of religious work, even if not kind of explicitly stated, or it's some sort of dance music. So yeah, those are the two kind of main influences that we see in his music. And then I suppose if you want another fun fact about the man, he was always either making another composition or another kid, because that man had so many compositions and so many kids. So that's your fun fact for tonight. So as I was saying, there's a big religious influence in a lot of his music, and his piece is no exception. So we have, now I'm going to awkwardly walk over to the piano. Four notes. So a common feature that we see in his music is a sort of cross motif. So if you look at those notes as they're written on the page, you can kind of draw lines between them and it makes a cross. So in a way, you could perhaps see this piece as a sort of musical depiction of maybe the crucifixion. So what a great way to set the mood, am I right, for the beginning of the night? Well, so there's two parts to this. There's a prelude and a fugue. So the fugue is where we hear that motif over and over again. So you'll hear it low, you'll hear it high, you'll hear it in the middle. So keep your ears open for that. So yeah, I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
the next piece is by a composer I think everyone knows. I mean, has anyone here not heard of Beethoven? So again, I want to start by talking a little bit about who Beethoven was as a person. So he was infamously hot-tempered and impolite, quite an intense personality. In some ways a bit arrogant, you could even say. But this can be seen in his music, this kind of his temperamental nature, because in practically all of his music there's so much contrast, so many different characters, one second happy, one second sad. So here in this piece, it's the first movement of his seventh piano sonata, and me in this piece, I hear a lot of mischief and humor. So like I was saying, plenty of different characters and lots of contrast. And Beethoven always wanted bigger pianos. He always wanted more sound. There's, you can see in the letters that he used to write to piano manufacturers back in the 18th, early 19th century, he was always practically begging them to make bigger instruments that could produce a larger volume of sound. So I wonder what he would have thought if he could hear his compositions played on the gigantic pianos we have today. But I guess we'll never know. And it's interesting because in this piece, there's actually, there are some notes that are in brackets because they didn't, those keys are so far down that they didn't exist on the piano that existed in Beethoven's time. So it's sort of up to the choice of the performer whether to include them or not, but I think Beethoven would have wanted to hear those low notes. So I'm gonna play the low notes. So, yeah, Beethoven's seventh sonata, first movement.
Thank you.
So, the next piece is, I can barely even understand these talking points, I don't know what's going on about. So our next piece is the next two pieces are two preludes by Rachmaninoff. So Rachmaninoff is one of, if not my one favorite composer, I think. So these two preludes are part of a larger set, Opus 23. So I'm going to play the fourth and fifth one from that set today. So that's the D major and the G minor. So the D major is definitely not as well known as G minor, but it, in my opinion, is one of the most just incredible pieces of music he ever wrote. So again, to talk about a little bit about who the composer was as a person. Rachmaninoff struggled a lot with depression, and after the premiere of his first symphony received some very harsh reviews, he just fell into a very deep depression, and he had a sort of writer's block and wrote very few compositions, most if not all of which he did write were commissioned, so composing just for the sake of it wasn't something he really did. So then he received treatment from a doctor, I might have the name wrong, Nikolai Dahl, I think. And that doctor treated him for his depression with hypnotherapy, and he improved, it worked basically. And so after that, he wrote one of the most famous pieces of music of all time, his second piano concerto, and he actually dedicated it to that doctor. And I know I'm talking about a completely different piece now, but in that concerto, I kind of hear, you know, the first movement is very dark. There's a lot of struggle and things, and I feel like that's representative of the struggle that the composer experienced himself. But then the second movement is just so tranquil and calm. There's such a sense of peace in it. And then the third movement is just full of life. It's very lively and joyful. And I feel like that's kind of his musical expression of a newfound appreciation for life that he gained after the treatment and things like that. So in this D major prelude, I hear a similar sense of serenity, of peace, a sense of inner calm. And then the G minor prelude, half this room has probably heard it. It's one of his most famous pieces. It's a very big contrast to the D major. For me, I think most people would agree, it seems to depict soldiers marching into battle. So we start off, the soldiers are marching from far away, and then they get closer and closer. And then we have a really beautiful melody in the middle section. So we have, you know, this war zone, it's marching, and then a very heroic second theme. And then back to the march theme, and then suddenly we're just taken into this completely different world entirely with one of the most iconic melodies he ever wrote, and then back to the march for earlier. So I'm going to ask that you hold any applause between the two preludes, because I think that it's nice to hear the two as a pair rather than two individual pieces. So yeah, Rachmaninoff's two preludes. Hope you enjoy. So the next piece is also a piece that's been with me for quite a while, and it was with me for some of my kind of, for a few milestones. It was one of the pieces that I played for my college audition. So it's Chopin's Third Ballade. And so a ballade is basically just a story told through music. And Chopin wrote four of these ballades, and they're thought to have been inspired by various poems by I've forgotten where he's from, some Eastern European poet called Mickiewicz. And this ballade in particular is thought to have been inspired by a poem about a sort of a sea nymph. So you can create your own interpretation when you hear it, but for me, I can definitely hear at the beginning, it's a sort of intimate dialogue, something quite romantic, and then that's the introduction, and it's quite a dance-like section, reminiscent of some Polish folk dances. So before I start waffling, I should, like I was doing for the other ones, talk about Chopin as a composer and person. So Chopin was deeply sensitive and quite introverted. His music is often referred to as a sort of salon music. Even when his music gets really loud, it's still somehow elegant. So this piece is quite characteristic of him because he was Polish. He had a French name, but he was Polish. And after the Poland was invaded, he had to flee, and he spent most of his life after that in Paris, and he was never able to return to Poland. And he always expressed a great homesickness. He always really missed Poland, and so in a lot of his music we can hear influences from traditional Polish folk dances like mazurkas and polonaises. So the first section after the introduction in this piece has elements of such dances. Then we go to a second theme, which at first seems very innocent, but it's sort of deceptively innocent. So if we take that poem about the sea nymph as inspiration, then maybe this is her entrance. So it's up to you just to decide what's going on through all the different episodes. But at the final section, it ends very triumphantly. So I suppose I leave it up to all of you. I don't want to kind of influence your thinking too much. I'll leave it up to all of you to decide who the characters are and who is it that's so triumphant in the end. So hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
Scriabin was a Russian composer who would have been a contemporary of Rachmaninoff, who we heard in the first half of the concert. So Scriabin, I could talk for a long time about his personality, but to put it into one word, insane. And I mean that in the most literal sense. He believed, he had sort of God complex. He thought, at the time of his death, he was writing a composition that he believed would like trigger the apocalypse if you played it in like the Himalayas or something. He was insane, completely insane. But he had a few different periods in his life, as in his compositions can be sort categorized by sort of his earlier period, so young Scriabin. Then we have sort of a middle period and a later period. So the later period is where the music is about as insane as he is. So we're not hearing any very late Scriabin today, unfortunately. I don't have any very late Scriabin in my repertoire, but we are going to hear early Scriabin and middle Scriabin. So I'm playing three of his etudes. The first one is Opus 2, number 1, C sharp minor, probably one of his most well-known pieces. And so this is, he wrote it when he was young. So there's actually, and one of the reasons I decided to put these etudes right after the Chopin Ballade is because particularly in his earlier period, Scriabin's music had a lot of influences from Chopin's music. So lots of similarities in style and even composing the same types of pieces like preludes, etudes, like I'm playing today, mazurkas, waltzes, and so on. So Opus 2, number 1 is quite a tragic piece. There's a lot of sadness, a lot of grief in it. But still, we're starting to see that, and I wrote in the program notes about the intensity and volatility of Scriabin's music, but we're already, that's reflective of his personality. And I think it's not quite as extreme, but we can start to see that here. There are changes in mood, although not as erratic as in his later music. Then the second etude is in E major, Opus 8, number 5. Here that starts, that his sort of capricious nature becomes a bit more evident. It starts off very calm and content. There's a little bit of storminess, but mostly it's fine. You know, everyone gets moody once in a while. And then suddenly, out of nowhere, we kind of, a storm sort of comes. I suppose that's the best word to describe the middle section of that piece, stormy. There's, you know, anger, sadness, lots of adjectives. And then back to super happy fun times, and it ends, the ending is very blissful and sweet. And then the last etude is one of my favorite pieces that he ever wrote, and it might be my favorite piece out of all the pieces I've played in my life. It's the Opus 42, number 5 etude, also in C sharp minor, so we're making a sort of loop here. And this one is more of his middle period, almost getting into his later period, but it's definitely not quite as strange as some of his later works. But here we really see that, as I said, the intensity and volatility. So there's kind of, it starts off very anxious. There's a quite a ominous left-hand figure. There's something going on. There's a lot of suspense, and the music gets a bit more frantic as it goes on. And suddenly we're taken into the most beautiful, most lyrical theme ever. And then back to an even more intense version of the first theme, then back to that beautiful lyrical second theme, and then finally a very tragic coda with, I'm going to play you a little motif. So one thing, again, I don't want to kind of influence anyone's thinking, but one thing, I mean, Scriabin liked a lot of things, but one of the things that he really liked was birds. He really liked birds. And I saw a masterclass by a great piano professor. And in that masterclass, he spoke about his kind of interpretation of the music. And he heard it as a sort of a musical depiction of a bird going on its death rattle flight. So this kind of, you'll hear it when I play, but the kind of left-hand figure I was talking about, and there's a sort of wailing feeling to it. Like it's, there's some sort of struggle, you know, and then a sort of, I guess, determination that comes before death, maybe. I don't know, I don't think anyone here has died before, so. but yeah, that motif that I played, the boom, that's very ominous, and that professor referred to it as the death motif. So, yeah, beautiful, beautiful piece, lots of different emotions. There's fear, anxiety, there's so much love, there's determination, but ends very tragically. So, yeah, again, I want to ask that you hold any applause between the three etudes, as I would really like the three of you to be heard as not a pair. So, yeah, anyways, I hope you. So the next piece on the program is a piece by a French composer called Forêt. And by the way, I am very proud of my H1 in French, so I will be saying everything. Yeah, I hear the O's. I will be pronouncing all the French words in my best French accent. So the piece is called Romance sans paroles, which means romance without words. So romance without words, I guess trying to say words about it goes against the point of the piece. So I let you use your imaginations. The music and the title kind of speak for themselves anyway. Instead, I would like to tell you a story about how I discovered this piece, because I had never heard of it. I'd heard of the composer, but not the piece. So probably most, if not all of you know or remember, probably were even there, when I gave a recital out in the foyer back in 2019. So after the concert, now I'm not sure if he's here. If you are here, Patrick, I'm not going to make you stand up or anything, don't worry. But a man named Patrick came up to me after the concert, and he, you know, told me how he enjoyed the concert and things like that. And he told me about how there was a piece he always wanted to hear played live. There's something floating. Because he always really loved the piece. And it was this piece. And a while after the concert, something was left for me and Glór. So he had come in and he had printed the score and written, you know, handwritten. There was a handwritten letter / note on the back. Just again, you know, thanking me for the concert, saying he enjoyed it and saying how he loves this piece and would like to hear it played live, and hoped that maybe someday I could do that. So I was really touched by that, especially since he came all the way from Connemara to hear the concert. Yeah, so 3 years later, I'm finally playing it. So, and I'm really glad that he told me about this piece, because it's a great one. It's small, short, but it's really lovely. So I hope you love.
Thank you.
First of all, I would like to address a very important question that I am more than sure you will all be asking once I start playing. You're all going to be thinking, is that really what it's supposed to be, what it's supposed to sound like? And the answer is yes. I promise that's actually what the piece sounds like. So this piece is called The Cat and the Mouse by an American composer named Aaron Copland. So this is a more modern piece. So at this stage in music, and I mean, this was kind of on the program notes, so, and you've probably noticed that we've kind of been going chronologically during this concert. So starting with the oldest, like Bach, and then Beethoven, and going forward to the later composers. So this is Copland. So he was a more modern composer, like I just said. And his music, this piece, we can see lots of different influences. We can see kind of very unusual harmonies that were kind of coming into fashion at that time in classical music. Composers started to kind of break the rules and think a bit outside the box, kind of go against everything. That's the second time that's happened. Kind of just go against everything that had kind of been set in place before. So lots of very unusual dissonant harmonies that just might not sound very pleasant, but I think that altogether the piece is quite interesting. And then there's also kind of influences of jazz and some of the harmonies. The middle is like a really beautiful tango. So to talk a bit about the piece itself and what I think of it, because I said I didn't want to influence anyone's thinking, but a piece like this needs to be explained. Who here has heard, or who here has watched Tom and Jerry? Everyone, yeah. So, basically think of Tom and Jerry. So, we have a really beautiful opening, just a bar or two. It seems like everything is normal. It's just a nice melody, an interesting chord, maybe it's, you know, the cat saying hello. Then, well, I don't want to spoil anything, but you're going to hear a cat and a mouse, as the title may suggest. So you'll hear the cat, you know, trying to coax the mouse out of hiding, maybe, like, you know, hello, want to have a bit of dinner with me? I mean, you might be the dinner, but you're not. I'm not telling you that. You can hear the mouse kind of just running around, chasing each other. In the middle, I guess the cat has a sort of monologue, because there's a very, like, hello, how are you doing kind of thing in the middle. So that's kind of, I guess you could think of that as the cat just kind of, like I said, trying to just, you know, like, hello mouse, come out. And then it gets very frantic after that, and it gets a bit chaotic. So, you know, I think that you all know Tom and Jerry, like you're saying, so imagine those episodes where, you know, they're running around and, like, everything's falling down. The kitchen table's falling over, the flower vase fell off the windowsill, the roof came down, and now the house is just, like, a pile of debris, and then the owner comes, and, yeah. That's what happens, and then we have kind of these almost, like, funeral bells, so it's like, wow, this is this got a bit out of hand, didn't it? And then a very funny little ending, so, you know, maybe the owner comes home, and it's like, Tom, Jerry, what has happened here? And it's just like,